all attendance and engagement related projects at EdAdvance. And I would love if we could skip to the next slide and we could introduce our colleagues here joining us from all over the country from our partners at AttendanceWorks. So welcome to Hetty Chang, the Executive Director of AttendanceWorks, Susan Lieberman, the Senior Fellow at AttendanceWorks, and Ainika Williams, who is the Associate Director for Policy. So we are very grateful to have their expertise here to share with you today. We'd also like to take a moment to introduce our guru and partner at CSDE, Kari Sullivan Custer, who many of you have probably met. She is involved in everything attendance related around the state, and we're so lucky to have her. And I'd also like to introduce my colleague, Francisco Baires at CREC, who is another key partner in everything we do related to attendance in Connecticut. And he is running all the back-end tech for us today. So we are most appreciative of that. Next slide, please. So as we get rolling here, we'd love for you all to take a moment and just use the chat to share your name, your role, your school and district, and really think about what or who motivated you to attend school every day when you were a student. So I just think back to my own education, and I was motivated by my parents valuing education, but also I just loved school. So loved my teachers, loved the community, and we're curious to see what brought you to school every day. Oh, I love that. Sports was a motivator. My husband is an athletic director. He would appreciate that one. Principal. Okay, sports. Ooh, alternative ed. So much variety. Oh, I'm seeing lots of folks actually writing that their family members were teachers. I loved my teacher, seems to be a common theme.
Lots of comments about friends too, Carolyn.
Yes, motivated by friendships. It's so, so important. Well, thank you all. We'll keep that rolling as folks continue to join. I'm also seeing a lot of people just saying that they enjoyed school, which really is our hope here in Connecticut. We want to get students to be enjoying school, and that's the name of the game. So thank you all for doing that as we continue. I did just want to provide a little bit of an overview and context for why we are holding this e-learning series. So as I mentioned, I just left the classroom about 18 months ago and have become entrenched in all this AttendanceWorks. But really, I want to sort of connect the dots and think about this focus on attendance and engagement and other ongoing initiatives at CSDE and the RESC Alliance. We know you all have so many competing priorities, and so we appreciate that you have taken time today to join us and really think deeply about attendance. So when I think about why should we be caring about focus and attendance, focusing on attendance, one big reason, of course, is that chronic absenteeism has become even more of a challenge during this pandemic era. But beyond the statistics and data, attendance and engagement is more often than not at the heart of all of the big picture thinking and initiatives that school districts are grappling with. So we can think of attendance and engagement as the umbrella under which so many different intertwined priorities fall. So as many of you probably know, the RESC Alliance kicked off a multifaceted professional learning experience this fall called Igniting Change. And this really focuses on meeting the needs of all schools and districts throughout Connecticut by providing equity-centered learning opportunities. These were grounded in four different professional learning pathways, and the high-leverage pathways include areas such as inclusive school culture, equity-centered leadership. And I was at the kickoff session for one of these pathways a few weeks ago, and it was really heartening to see so many Connecticut districts and school leaders genuinely invested in this work and looking for ways to move their districts forward. I'm sure that we can all agree that as educators, all of the work we're doing as educational leaders is interrelated. And I think that really comes into play when we think about attendance. we can't talk about attendance and engagement without thinking about the root causes of absenteeism, right? And the bottom line is that if our students are feeling like they're included and that they belong, and if our district and school leadership creates policies and culturally responsive school climates with inclusion and equity front and center, then our students and our families will be much more likely to be engaged, to be present, and to be successful. So as we think about attendance and engagement, let's view it as the intersection of everything that we do. If we don't create climates where kids feel safe and welcome, if we don't create dynamic, diverse, passionate teacher workforces, if we don't lead through an equity lens, and if we don't meet kids where they are offering culturally responsive curriculum, our students are going to be less eager to come to school. However, the reverse is true too, right? So if we keep attendance, belonging, and engagement as sort of our North Star guiding the work that we do, then our students and our families are much more likely to be our allies and work together to make attendance a routine priority. So we are so lucky to have the partnership of our colleagues at AttendanceWorks. I have no doubt that their expertise they are about to share with you is going to be super helpful for you and your team as you move forward with attendance work in your district. So we thank you so much for being here. And I would like to turn it over to Hedy as she gets us rolling with the slide deck.
Great. Thank you so much. It is truly a pleasure to be here and to partner and continually have the opportunity to partner with all of you in Connecticut. Good to see both many familiar faces and some new ones. So let me give you a quick preview of what we're going to do, because this is a 3-session series. During this first session, and if you could mute, please, if you are, that would be great. This is going to be a 3-session series. The first session is about whole school engagement strategies for reducing student absenteeism. The second session is really about early intervention, and we're going to also talk about what needs to be in a team and what are the functions of a team. And then the third session is about partnering to make a difference, both with families as well as with other agencies, so that we can really implement this tiered support approach. Next slide. So today's session, to dive a little deeper, is going to be how do you draw upon those whole school strategies to ensure we have positive conditions for learning and are creating those relationships that we know are so essential. We're going to make sure everyone's introduced to a framework of multi-tiered attendance strategies and talk about the communications that are part of that tier one universal approaches. I will say that I know there are some people on this in the audience who've been around for a lot of these will be very familiar slides. My hope is you can look at it and think about, well, how can I use any of these slides in my own work? This series got started because we needed to create a 101 to make sure everyone in Connecticut, including some of the districts who have not previously had to work on chronic absence, are familiar with the basic concepts. That's also why it's being recorded, so you can share this. But this is really aimed at more ensuring everyone is on a level playing field. But for those of you who are more experienced, you might see that we keep AttendanceWorks is always updating slides. We're always trying to make information a little more engaging, and that might help you in your own work to be able to engage other folks in your own districts so that they can do this work. Next slide. So let's do a quick overview. Again, this is 101. We want to make sure we're on the same playing field. Next slide, please. So absenteeism is really a leading indicator and a cause of educational inequity. That's why we care. It is it's like a canary in the coal mine that helps us understand when an individual student or a group of students are at risk of falling behind. When chronic absence happens, it's a challenge. It's a sign of challenges, both outside and inside schools. Outside schools like unstable housing, unreliable transportation, but inside schools like disengaging experiences and bullying that can cause students to actually, it affects their overall learning. So even if they're present, but they're missing some, even the days are there. These are signs of challenges that are affecting their learning. And in addition, it's causing them to miss more and more school, which then in turn exacerbates the educational inequities. And the high levels that we're seeing during the pandemic are further exacerbating the educational inequities that many students have faced even before the pandemic. Next slide. So nationally, chronic absence was about 8 million kids nationwide. We believe it has at least doubled across the country, or about doubled. And your data, and we'll talk about that, show it remains high. Early elementary, high school, and kids who, and your data actually shows a lot about this, that kids who remained longer and remote over the last, whatever, 3 years of the pandemic, who knew this would last so long, continue to have challenges. Carolyn, can you share us, talk to us some about the Connecticut data? And let's go to the next slide.
Sure. Thank you, Hetty. So first of all, Connecticut does a really terrific job of collecting data. We are one of the only states in the nation that has such a robust data collection system that is monthly. So the data you are seeing on this slide is the monthly data collected from November of 2022, just to orient you. We are in the midst of getting the December data all cleaned up and ready for presentation. But when you look at this slide, really what we want to orient you to is that chronic absence has doubled from pre-pandemic levels. And that is just huge. The data shows that it is still remaining pretty high, even now. So that's really context-based as we think about why everybody is, you know, worrying about attendance and thinking about attendance. This is a really important piece of data to keep in mind, that we haven't returned to pre-pandemic levels when we think about chronic absenteeism. Just to orient you to the colors on the graph you're seeing, the gray is the 2019-20 year, so beginning of the pandemic. 2021 is that darker blue color, orange 21-22, and then the most recent data is that lighter blue color for the current school year. So Hetty's going to talk a little bit more about sort of that outside lens. She's got the nationwide perspective and thinking about how that relates to our data in Connecticut. But these are just good visuals for you to have as you think about this, as Hetty provides a little more context.
So outside, I will say there are many, many states, like the state I'm living in, which we have even higher levels of chronic absence than you face. So we're at 30%. I see some states at 35%. Historically, because you've done so much work, I believe, Connecticut's actually been on the lower end. So while you're doubling, you're still not as high as some of other places, even though having a quarter of your kids is you know, horrible information. But it could be worse. Because I want you to know that the investments in Connecticut, even though this is very disturbing information, are still making a difference. And I also want to point out that you all have sort of held the line and in some cases decreased chronic absence a little for your highest need kids. What is really also causing some of the statewide rates to be higher is your non-high needs are actually tripling in the number of non-high needs kids who are chronically absent. They're a much bigger percentage of your chronic absence population. I will also say, know that this is data for November. So the challenging news is that often the beginning of the year data, if you don't do anything about it, can predict the end of the year data. And sometimes, you know, spring and June can get worse. On the other hand, beginning of the year data can be addressed. These kids haven't missed 18 days. They've missed something like 9 days. And if you can prevent their chronic absence, you can actually reduce the number of kids who are chronically absent later on. And one of the things we'll be talking throughout this series is how do we understand the whys? And the whys for higher, less high needs kids, higher, more affluent kids may be a little different than kids who are struggling, economically struggling kids. And so that's just something you'll wanna keep in mind as we go through this work. Next slide. So why did we care about this? It matters. If you click Francisco, because we know that, you know, if you want to succeed in all these grades, going to school is a key pivotal part. And if you don't, if you are starting to be chronically absent, if you click again, Francisco, chronic absence in pre-K and first can predict, click again, inability to read on grade level and actually poor math in the early grades, lower achievement in middle school, and then poor, less likelihood to graduate and more likelihood to drop out in high school. Next slide. And when we mean chronic absence, it's meaning missing 10% or more of school, including excused, unexcused suspensions. Don't matter so much the reason why. And I will say you all in Connecticut have more consistent data because you have also been pretty consistent in saying that a day of attendance is that you have to show up for at least half the school day. So you have some of the best data in the country. Now, chronic absence is different from truancy, which is only unexcused absences or average daily attendance. Next slide. So this is Connecticut data showing how you could even have 95% chronic absence. That's still even 10% of your kids, but look at 92, 93%. You can still you can have as much as 19% or 92%. You have as high as 23%, almost a quarter of your kids chronically absent. Average daily attendance. Often we think of 90% is an A. It's not. Sometimes you're doing okay, but often it's masking large numbers of kids who are chronically absent. And this is why you need to look both at average daily attendance, which kind of says how many kids on roll typically show up each day versus which kids are missing so much school they might be academically and socially at risk. Next slide. And this is really different from truancy. This is just data that we happen to have from when my own school district, we were trying to convince them to look at this. And the black line was the kids who had missed 10 unexcused absences. The top line was the kids who had been chronically absent. And what you could see is that the chronic absence was masking high levels, especially in the early grades. By the way, the high school data gets a little, at the end of high school gets a little weird. If you have a lot of dropout, it can actually lead to apparent improvements that aren't really improvements. And so it's really important to understand these are different things. Chronic absences, including unexcused, and just looking at unexcused can mask who is missing too much school. Next slide. This is really a shift. Across the country, we've always focused on truancy, which is counting only unexcused absences. Chronic absence counts all absences. When you look at truancy, it tends to emphasize, this is about compliance. It's part of our compulsory ed. You must show up to school. Whereas chronic absence is saying, you know what? When you don't show up to school, you don't have access to learning opportunities, connecting to peers, connecting to resources on school, at the school site. Truancy tends to take more blaming and punitive solutions. I will say in Connecticut, unlike most places, you all don't allow for court intervention. So you've actually been moving away from a punitive approach, from a kind of legalistic approach. But what we know is so important is that you need to take a prevention, problem-solving, trauma-informed approach that cultivates family and student engagement. And that's what chronic absence is really more about. Next slide. I would love for you to just write down or just think about this. If you have a spare piece of paper, you can do it. When you think about your own school that you're working or your school system, which approach do you think they're mostly doing? Are they mostly in truancy? Are they mostly in looking at chronic absence? Or are they maybe doing both? Are they kind of confused by both? You know, so think for just a second. What do you think is going on? And I will say at attendance works, we started looking mostly at chronic absence, but then we realized sometimes there's these underlying truancy practices that were getting in the way. They were so negative and punitive. Families would hear a punitive note, get a punitive response, which then was actually inhibiting our ability to reach out to them in a kind of chronic absence way that was really focused in a more positive way. So this is something we'll come back to, but I think it's important to keep in mind that we have truancy systems and chronic absence systems. We do believe that it's important to kind of shift to that positive problem-solving approach, and I can see some folks have, but keep in mind that there are truancy practices that might still, in fact, be influencing how people respond when they see absences. Next slide. So what we think is, what we're finding from our experience, from our work, is that we need to really think about what's the pathway to effective practice. And I know, and those of you who have worked with us for the year, over the years, know we always talk about actionable data. And we love Connecticut for its commitment to actionable data. The issue, though, is that you have to know how to interpret data when you see it. If you see data on absences and someone starts with blame, oh, Kari didn't show up to school because Kari doesn't care, then having that actionable data might not actually help you do better work. So we started to talk a lot more about, we need to understand people's mindsets. So when they see and look at chronic absence data, they're taking it from a point of inquiry, not blame, but I need to figure out what's going on, and then build capacity to engage in effective strategies, which then allows you to achieve the outcomes that you want. All right, next slide. So the key here is really about taking a tiered approach, which many of you might see, but we're going to go through this pretty quickly just so we all are, again, on the same page. Next slide. So first of all, we know that what helps get students and families to school is positive conditions for learning. When kids feel physically, emotionally healthy and safe, belonging, connection, support, academic challenge, and the adults in the school building and the students are experiencing well-being and emotional competence so that they can engage in that relationship that is building, that is so critical to all of these key ingredients. So relationship building is at the center, but these other key positive conditions for learning are the things that really make sure kids want to show up to school. And if they don't want to show up to school, you're battling everything uphill. Next slide. So one of the things that we did in the pandemic, many of you might have seen this tiered approach, we added in a foundational level saying, in order to do the tiered approach effectively, we actually have to first build in those foundational supports and make sure they're there. And one of the reasons we think high levels of chronic absence occur is when we don't have the foundational supports. So you're battling uphill to get kids to want to be there. It's upon those foundational supports that then you can do tier one. And then if that's not sufficient, tier two. And then if that's not sufficient, tier three intensive intervention. But your other levels, that those three, the pyramid above the foundational supports, aren't as effective if you don't have that base in place. I'm going to talk first a little bit about the tiers and then come back to foundational. And I will just say one other thing. Foundational supports are not something that just the folks working on attendance work on. That's something that a whole school has to take shared responsibility for putting in place, a whole school and community. Next slide. But if you think about the attendance interventions, this is about clear, concise communications, personalized, positive, hey, I missed you, making sure folks know the importance of showing up to school, making sure that you recognize good and improved attendance, not just perfect attendance where kids might feel like they don't ever have a chance to succeed. I'd be curious if you could just put in chat, what are some of the tier one things that you're doing? What has been most essential? And this is a tier one attendance interventions. I know folks have been doing some. So what are some of the tier one interventions that you guys have been putting in place successfully? Connections, parent meetings, and this is for everyone, communications from the classroom teachers. So if you're doing parent meetings, like parent-teacher home visiting with all families, that makes it part of actually the foundational supports are universal, but clear communications is absolutely part of tier one, making sure that teachers are part of that. Making sure that you integrate this with PBIS and making short, like weekly perfect attendance can, and most improved can help. So clear and celebrations, absolutely. So you have a lot, I suspect, going on around tier one. This is something that's often a strength that schools have, and you should maintain it. Let's go to tier two for a second. So then for some kids, though, those tier one interventions aren't enough. You have to add in more personalized interventions. So the LEAP home visits is a perfect example of adding in a more personalized home visit, having success mentors, mentors who can connect to kids multiple times a year, check in, check out, which sometimes people think about more as behavior, but it actually can be used for attendance as well. Noticing when you actually have a common barrier to getting to school, like maybe kids are having a challenge with food, nutrition, healthcare, that can also be another thing that sometimes are like kids who have chronic health issues, making sure they have a health plan can be part of this. And then for some kids though, tier two just isn't sufficient enough. And so you go to the next slide, that's when you have to really have more of your interagency case management, your educational supports. Some of the work that, a lot of the work that you all have done in Connecticut around truancy falls into this mix. And what I will just say again, and I know courts aren't part of this, but whenever we're talking nationally, it's really talking about legal intervention as a last resort. Next slide, please. And I now want to return that all of these tiers of intervention have to really sit on top of investments in these foundational supports. So if you click again, Francisco, for physical, emotional health and safety, that's those healthy learning environments, creating that welcoming, safe climate, making sure that you have restorative circles. Next slide. And then building in relationship connecting. And I know a number of people on this call have done that, where you build in advisories, enrichment clubs, peer group connections, making sure that student voice is part of influencing what you do. And then thinking about how do you create academically challenging and engaging school experiences, learning experience. Maybe it's project-based learning. Maybe it's credit recovery so kids don't lose hope, but they know that they can stay in. Maybe it's about internships and community service, and then investing in the adult and student well-being with your restorative check-ins, making sure healthcare is available to everyone in the school, just both the teachers and the faculty, the staff, as well as the kids, and ensuring that you're really investing in trauma-informed care and staff self-care. And again, these things then, which are not just the responsibility of people who we think of as working on the attendance supports, are what allow all the other tiers to be effective. And let's go to the next slide. And you can see this video. We're gonna show this video showing, this does not look quite the right video.
The atmosphere of the school, like you're around adults, and you're even after years, you're around other peers that make you want to do better. They make you want to learn. Your friends and the teachers make learning fun and make it also possible.
Student engagement is about relationship building. It's also about helping students know what they're learning in class and why that learning is key to succeeding and having a different kind of future, a good future.
One thing we beg on student voice, student to have a voice in decisions that are made here. You know, they might not have the last say, but they have input.
At the high school level, it's so much more up to the students than it is when they're younger. And so part of us creating such a strong pull is to get the kids to want to be here.
Good morning, how are you?
You have to make it safe. You have to make it someplace they want to be. So what that is, you gotta have everybody want to be accepted and accept each other and be voices heard.
They need to know that we care about them, and they don't want to just hear it. They want to see it and feel it. And once you develop that culture, then the kids they love being at school.
Sometimes when I miss a day, I feel like I'm nothing without you guys here. And like when I'm sick, I miss school and I want to come.
I want to make them want to come to class. So whatever I need to do to make sure that they want to come, that's part of my overall pedagogy.
Whatever I can to pull them in and to try to hold them for that time.
When she teaches, I think that like I have a good time, and it's like, you know, I'm in a fun class, but we are at the same time, we're learning something really fun.
I had to really let myself, let them dictate to me, you know, through this, their body language on what works best for them.
If they see value, they're more likely to come and enjoy what they're doing.
Every morning, we have morning meeting. For us, it's a house meeting. It's a family meeting. This is when we get to greet them. You get to check students and see how their day has been, how their evening has been. Sometimes you can get out in front of, you know, student challenges or how someone's feeling, if you can connect with them early in the morning and start your day right.
Just like any adult, you know, you want to do meaningful work and you want to be able to do your best work. And so I think when the kids are using the arts to express themselves, they're doing long-term inquiry, they're able to follow their own interests, you know, they're doing self-expressive work and creative work, I think that makes them want to come. You know, it makes them want to come to school. And when they're here, they have good work to do.
Here we go.
This is a place students want to be. I mean, if you feel when you walk around, it feels home-like. And it's not a place you're coming just to get your work done. I think the opposite we have here. Kids want to be here, whether we're doing work or not, they like it here. And that's the first step to getting kids engaged in education is being present. And they want to be present.
But now some days we can't get them to go home. It's like, oh my gosh, it's 6 o'clock. Why are you still here? But it's a good thing. And we'd rather they be safe and feel at home here with us than to be looking for some other activities.
Francisco, I'm going to suggest we pause now. Oh, good. We're automatically pausing. And I'm going to turn things over to Susan to facilitate the next piece.
Thank you, Hetty. So when you saw this video, how did this video illustrate the positive conditions for learning for you? What are some specific examples that stood out for you, or what really resonated with you? You can add it in the chat. The morning meeting, connecting with students, really just starting the day with that. That morning meeting check-in is really about those relationships. Absolutely. Students being a safe place, connecting, that sense of belonging, community. That's a really big piece of this. Is how do we bring that community and that sense of community, the teacher-student relationships. That I think one of the students said that it's not just the relationships with the teachers, but also feeling safe with the students. The students wanted to be there, that sense of connection. Thank you. These are great, the positivity to it. These are great. Thank you very much. I think this is really all part of those foundations of learning, those conditions of learning, those basic strategies. Next slide. Thank you all for your feedback on this. So let's go deeper into the conditions for learning and consider what's happening in your school community. So we're going to start with adult and student well-being and social emotional competence. So you can see on the left side that there's different challenging conditions you may confront that range from adults not being developmentally responsive. For example, staff responding to middle schoolers the same way you'd respond to 12th graders, or adults sending direct or indirect messages saying the certain students don't have potential because they're from a specific neighborhood or family. We know there's a range of those challenging conditions. Now we want to think about, what are those positive conditions that are in place? How are the students in your school building taking care of themselves? And how are the adults in your school building taking care of yourself, caring of themselves and others? So if you can add in the chat, what are those positive conditions that are in place in your school? Adults is tuned to student development. There's resources for adults to practice self-care, and that's that staff-to-staff relationships. Or adults believe in the potential of all students to learn. Or the opportunities for people to develop those self-awareness, self-management, not just in the beginning of the school year, but throughout the school year. folks want to write in the chat, what's a positive condition that's in place in your school that you really notice? These are the things, your wellness Wednesdays once a month. That's nice. Is that for both students and staff? Belief that all students can learn, no matter what's going on, they can all learn. Belief, feeling of connection and belonging. That's great. And that's connection classes. I've never heard of connections classes, but those sound great. Thank you. Effective PBIS strategies. Motivation Monday. Nice. Teachers are invested. So thank you. These are all things that are all going to lead to that social emotional connection and the student and adult, and not to forget the adult well-being. Next slide. So here's physical and emotional safety. We know the challenging conditions that exist. But what are the positive conditions that exist in your school? And for this, we're going to bring up a poll. So Francisco, if you could bring up a poll and think of what are the positive conditions that exist for physical and emotional safety. And when we think of emotional safety, we're thinking about establishing that trusting with another person and feeling safe, and that psychological a belief that you won't be humiliated for what you're doing, that it's safe to be in your school, and low risk learning, that it's okay. Everybody understands that there's an acceptance. This is wonderful. This is really interesting. So emotional safety is really consistently the highest. That sense that, people are feeling safe in their school. I think a few more are coming through, but it's remained pretty consistent. And that's so important. And then take a look at these other areas and these other conditions and think about what could we do to help people feel more safe, psychologically safe, where they feel that they can open up and speak, or that people feel safe no matter what, however they their identity, and it creates a sense of belonging for each person's background, and whether it be age, race, gender, culture, or language. Thank you. How about go to the next slide? And let me remove the poll from my screen. So there's also belonging, connection, and support. And what are we doing? And it looked like from all of your responses earlier that you really are thinking about those meaningful connections to adults in school, that greeting students individually really does make a difference, and showing that adults are emotionally attuned to students. So think about this and think about where's your strength and where can you, and what can you strengthen so that there's better sense of community and connection in your schools. And the next one is, next slide, please. And the academic challenge and engagement. Again, think about this, think how this works for you. And are there high expectations for all students? Many times students who are homeless will say, don't lower your expectations, keep your expectations high. Maybe think about the quantity of work you're asking me to do, but don't lower your expectations. And think about those opportunities to learn. All right, now, next slide. Now we're going to have you break out into smaller groups and really, learn from the expertise in this room. And really, this is a chance for you to share. So we want you as a small group to talk about think of these two questions. What creates a sense of belonging, connection, and support in your school? And how do you reach students and families who've been disconnected? We will take, let's take, Francisco, is it possible to, why don't we keep to 12 minutes? Make sure you turn off your video camera, briefly introduce yourselves. Just be aware that we are open to all questions. Make sure that all intentions are good. And so everybody can ask a question, and the person whose first name is closest to the letter A should facilitate. Francisco, could you break everyone in groups? Thanks. Welcome back, everyone. Welcome back. Thank you. Please share out in the chat, what is a strategy? What's sort of a new strategy or something that you were reminded of that you heard today? So please let us know, pop it in the chat. What's a strategy you've heard about today that you'd like to strengthen or adopt? Get to know the student. That's right. I build on that trusted adult, having the student identify that trusted adult. Focusing, personal checkout, personal check-ins. Those really do make a difference.
Susan, you're muted.
Oh.
I'm no, not- I can hear Susan, Anika.
There's consistency through the district. That's definitely true. If somebody at the door is greeting everybody and saying, we're glad to see you here, even though the student's late, it's really important that somebody, that everyone in the classroom is also greeting that student. Thank you. Thank you for your ideas. Let's get to the next slide and talk about those relationships. Hedy?
Yes.
Oh. Or Anika?
Yep. So good afternoon, Anika Williams. And I'm going to build a little bit about on some of the concepts that Susan shared regarding the positive conditions of support. So I first want to say, prior to coming to Attendance Works, I was the Upward Bound director. I ran this after school program in a very rural county, had the highest poverty rates in the state of Florida and the lowest graduation rates. And our job was solely to get these kids to come to school and to go to college. And given the statistics, we did a very good job in accomplishing that. And so we conducted the study to understand, well, what was successful about the program? What made students want to come to school? What made them want to go to college? And what we found, and I was under the assumption, I said, well, I think it's because we're paying them. We paid them a weekly allowance to show up to tutoring and mentoring sessions. And I also thought it was the college tours. And in interviewing our students, we found that the reason they were coming to the program was because of the staff, right? So we had one male staff who was like a father figure to many of our students. And then we had another young woman who served as a college mentor, and they said, she was like my big sister. So I came to the program. And so I wanted to share that because sometimes we think that we have to invent all these new things and we've got to implement new programs. And sometimes it's again, it's just being able to connect with our students in our schools and our programs if they're on the sports teams. And that's what motivates students to be present. So that's the core foundation that I'm going to kind of dig into. Next slide. Okay, so relationship mapping. So I love this strategy because it is a high leverage activity. So meaning that it has a great impact and it costs absolutely nothing to implement. So in a nutshell, what relationship mapping does is it allows adults to connect with every single child in a school or in a grade level or on a sports team or in a program who may need support, whether that's academically, socially, or personally. And so there are three key steps. So the first thing you'd want to do is you'd want to generate a list of every single child in your school. Again, if it's a program, if you say, hey, we're going to target all of our ninth graders, and then you can invite staff, whether it's custodial staff, whether it's folks from the cafeteria, teachers, administrators, to come in and put a green circle or highlight a student that they have a relationship with. And then they will take a red marker and put a red dot next to the students that they don't, or students that they know may need extra support. And then the third step would be not requiring, because we don't want to ask folks to do more than they have to if they don't want to, but we want to motivate and charge our folks, our staff, to say, we are tasking you, or we're asking you to step in and to connect with those students who have the 5 or 10 red dots. Because again, those are the students that may not have that strong, stable relationship with someone at school or someone at home. And so again, charging and encouraging folks around us to step into this mentorship role that does not require much, may just require a check-in or two. Next slide. And so we're gonna present this video on routines and rituals, and then we will recap and talk about it after.
The start of a new school year is often filled with emotions and uncertainty, now more than ever. As you plan for the return to school, consider establishing a new practice that helps students feel warmly welcomed as they come back. We know students learn best when they feel safe and connected, and you'll be setting norms that will lay a strong foundation for classroom management right from the beginning. Rather than jumping into instruction, opening each class with an activity, routine, or ritual that connects students to each other in a meaningful way can build classroom community all year long. Daily wellness checks serve a dual purpose. They help strengthen and build students' self-awareness skills while giving you a quick pulse check on how each student in your class is doing. Tools such as zones of regulation or the mood meter give students a shared emotional vocabulary to express how they're feeling. You can ask students to volunteer individual updates or offer a central place where students can post their status to quickly understand where everyone is at that day. After months of being apart, students need to connect and build relationships. Go-around questions are a simple way to learn something about each other, share feelings, or just have fun as a group. Try an activity like Rose and Thorn, where each student offers one thing making them happy and one challenge. Or ask a question on a theme, like what are you looking forward to this weekend? You can also try circle games, which are a kinetic way to help build trust, like snowball toss or name in motion. In a snowball toss, students respond to a prompt like, what's your biggest hope for this year? Write it down on a piece of paper, crumble it, and toss it to the center. At the end, students pick up the snowballs and read them aloud, giving the class a feeling of solidarity and support. Grounding exercises offer a way to help center and uplift students at the start of class. Take a moment for 3 collective breaths. Focus on a calm down glitter jar or do a series of stretches to awaken students and let out any distracting energy. You can also try a 5-minute meditation. Use a recording from an app or lead students along with a visualization of your own. These exercises set a calm tone and let students know that school is a welcoming, peaceful place where they can learn and be supported. Even if you do not have time for a daily circle, smiling warmly and greeting each person by their preferred name as they enter your classroom makes students feel seen and builds a safe, inclusive classroom environment.
Okay, and I love this video because as I was reading responses to Susan's question, I saw that many of you are already doing a lot of this. I saw morning meetings, connection classes. Some of you talked about being intentional about creating a sense of belonging. So many of you are already checking the boxes. I want to reiterate that many of these routines and rituals, which creates this sense of connection and belonging is for students, are also strategies that work for us as adult learners. So this is not just a child thing. This is not just to get students to come to school, but we have to think about as humans that we appreciate, say, the daily wellness check-in. Someone is saying, how are you doing today? So as a first grade teacher, I remember having zones of regulations on my wall, and my students would come in and they had a little clip with their name on it, and they would indicate if they were happy, if they were sad, if they were angry. And I would notate it and say, okay, Johnny's on blue today. I'm going to make sure that at least I may not be able to solve what's going on at home. I may not be able to intervene right away, but a simple, is everything okay? I saw that you came in sad today. And just being able to lend a listening ear, again, creates that community and that sense of belongingness with you and your students. Whole group greeting. So again, in this video, they sat in a circle every day for a couple of minutes. Some of you all are already implementing that in your school district. When I think about the mindfulness and the grounding activities, I think about getting out the wiggles. So allowing students to get up and move. And I remember putting on a 30 minute song that the students would get up and they'd know it's time to stretch. And again, it's saying that I know you're tired. You've been sitting here for 2-3 hours. And here's a moment to get out those wiggles. And even as adults, we appreciate that when we're sitting in long meetings or conferences and getting an opportunity to just get up and stretch. And then last but not least, greeting at the door. So a simple smile or calling a person by their name. At my son's school, every Friday, all of the cheerleaders from the middle school comes over and they have these signs that says honk for kindness. And they've got music going and it is just, as what kids say, it is a vibe, it is an energy that my son appreciates and he's beelining out of the car to join all of that festivity. And again, that simple routine of holding up signs and having music on every Friday creates that ritual and routine that pulls students to want to come to school. So do we have any other ways that you all use rituals and routines in your schools or school district that you'd like to share? And I know we did that a little bit earlier, but anything else that comes to mind as we think about these four routines and rituals? Okay, you can go to the next slide. And so here's just some additional strategies. So we have two evidence-based programs that has been tried and true in the state of Connecticut and with it being implemented with fidelity has shown to be successful in improving attendance in the state of Connecticut. So we have the learner engagement and attendance program, and we have the parent teacher home visiting program. And of course, we will provide the slideshow presentation so that you can read more about these worthy programs that again has statistically shown to improve attendance in the state of Connecticut. And of course, there's mentoring, which is my favorite. Mentoring is universally understood and accepted as a strategy to get students to do well, to achieve, to show up, to be present, and to know that a trusted adult cares about them and create that sense of belongingness. And you can do it virtually now. As Upper Bound Director, when we had to pivot from face-to-face to virtual, we text students. Again, that simple check-in and checking to see how students are doing tells them that you matter to me. So I love mentoring. Next slide. And again, we talked about, these are some other additional relationship building links. We talked about the relationship mapping, the 2x10 charges mentors or whoever's coming in contact with students to make 10 contacts, I'm sorry, 2 contacts with students on 10 consistent days. Utopia relationship building, they also have resources and the National Partnership for Student Success. They offer TA technical assistance training in this area as well. And I'm going to turn it over to Hetty.
Great. Thank you so much, Anika. And so now we're going to shift over. And I did notice, you know, some folks were putting in a couple of things about the ways they built relationships. Sometimes it takes us a little while to add stuff into the chat. So feel free to continue adding to that. I know there's such a wealth of great practice going on in Connecticut. But now I'm going to shift to communication strategies. So hopefully many of you, you know, we did work together with CSDE, with Carolyn, with the RESCs to try to make sure that folks knew about our Showing Up Matters for Real toolkit. And this toolkit was created because we felt just talking to families about how if you miss school, just 2 days a month can show you, can get you off track for learning, wasn't actually quite the way to approach this, especially with all the pandemic. Many families knew their kids had missed a lot of school, and so you had to come up with a different messaging approach. And we've actually been, with support from Advance, actually doing some focus groups to kind of see how this messaging has played out. And let me say that one, this messaging is really helping you to think about talking to families about showing up to school matters for real, because it's an opportunity to, and click, build routines. And we thought this was really important because we know that daily attendance routines can really help to reduce stress, create a sense of safety and security, especially after chaotic transitions. And I feel like we've been in 3 years of chaotic transitions. Second, it's about an opportunity to increase, it's an opportunity to increase engagement. This is about the fact that when you're in school, you can really build relationships with peers and other school staff and also community partners. And I have to say that as everything has reopened, my appreciation for seeing people in person, talking to them, not just through a little box in a Zoom window, has greatly expanded. You know, one of the findings from the Leap home visiting was that when kids met in person with folks, or kids and families, whether it was in home or a community setting, it actually worked a bit more effectively than just our Zoom meetings, as much as we sometimes need to use Zoom meetings when that is not possible. Next, showing up to school matters because it provides access to resources. We certainly heard from, you know, when the pandemic struck, we all rallied around to provide access to meals. And that has been important, but schools still continue to be so important, especially with inflation and not having families not always having access to meals, but health and mental health services, tutoring, mentoring, technology, extracurriculars, after school, all of that is just so essential. And schools, when you come to school, it's not just the classroom, but it's all these other resources. Showing up matters because it's about supporting learning. And we still think that's important. It's not necessarily where you start with. And actually, you might need to think about where you start. The REAL acronym was meant to help us all remember. My memory has been failing me. I don't know whether that's too much or age or whatever, but REAL helps me remember routines, engagement, access to resources, learning. But sometimes where you start is different. I'm just thinking that one of the things we heard from these focus groups that we did with the RESCs was that in some cases, families are struggling so much with just meeting basic needs. You just got to start with access to resources. How can I help you deal with your homelessness? How your food insecurity? Then from that, you might be able to say, hey, routines are really helpful and engagement and learning. But you know, this is where you got to use your relationship to families to figure out what part of the messaging you start with first. And my hope is, and what you can do is go on to this toolkit, which is linked above, and we'll also put the links in the chat, and you'll get also the links at the end of this, that you, there's tons of resources on this Showing Up Matters for Real toolkit. We have the messaging, we have it in English and Spanish. We have different resources and strategies for you to use to implement this. Next slide. And, oh, actually, let's go back up. Just curious, do these tools resonate with you? Do these messages resonate with you? Don't know if anyone's used Showing Up Matters for Real, because it has been around for a few months, but we're still finding it to be helpful. If you're finding that you can use this, or that you found any of these messaging to be helpful, love for you to share in the chat. And Joe's saying that habits and routines are key. We have kind of been out of routine for 3 years. And I have to say, I especially worry for our youngest learners, our kindergartners, our first graders, they're even second grade. So how do we help them get back and reestablish maybe for the first time a routine of attendance? This is, by the way, where things like even a walking school bus, it can both be transportation, but it can also be about creating that routine. Helping families think about the routines they set up. All right, let's go to the next slide. So as you think about your partnerships and your communications, you really wanna, you might think about these tips for making sure that your communications forge these partnerships. One is that this isn't a one-shot deal. You gotta be communicating supportive messages throughout the year. So last year, for example, our messaging was stay connected, keep learning, because we knew that people needed to stay connected even when they were quarantined, when they couldn't get to school, and keep learning. You wanna make sure these are tailored, personalized, caring messages. And again, this is going back to not starting with any kind of punitive language, but caring support, and making sure that you're offering families and staff actionable steps to improve attendance. And making sure that families know there are really these basic needs resources that are available at school. And making sure families know what are some of the resources they can keep kids learning at home. And I will just say, this is important, especially we know that lower income families, economically challenged families, they both may struggle with these access to basic needs resources, but they also may struggle with making sure that they can keep kids learning at home. This may be one of the differences between more affluent and more lower income families. Affluent families have computers, they have access, resources to purchase tutors, other kinds of things. We need to ensure that when all kids are missing school, and all kids have access to these different learning resources. Next slide. I also want you to think about, this is really work that Todd Rogers, who's such a, been an amazing colleague and helped me think about this, is that we really actually also have to think about our communications. We want to tell families lots of things, but more is not always better. Sometimes less is better. Communications to family has to be readable. Fewer words. It has to make sure that a family with limited literacy can read it. Skimmability, bullets. And actually writing shorter messages is sometimes harder. You have to look at your message a couple times to hone it down to the most key points. And that means you can't just decide at the last minute to send a message to family. So you got to think about this in a programmatic way. You want to plan this both in terms of which audience am I trying to reach? When do I need to reach them? I know that something that, for example, that Kari has emailed me recently about is, we know that sometimes families will take off long periods of time around the holidays because they're trying to go back to home country. And what I think this is a tricky issue. You got to do a lot of messaging because there's real reasons why families want to, especially these days, to go back home. But then you want to help them think about not just if they're going to go home, how are they going to keep up learning? Or can they make it a different time? What are the consequences if their child is really struggling academically and they're going to miss out on key things? There are some consequences to going home, even though you're trying to do it. And I don't think we can make the decision for family, but we can help get families to have as best informed decisions as possible. Now you want to communicate to that family, you're going to have to communicate to families before they've purchased their airplane tickets. So you're going to have to think about, I might need to do that as soon as school starts. And then reiterate it later on. And absolutely, Susan, translated to home language. So the idea, though, is you think about throughout a whole school year, what are those different times that you need to communicate, and then make sure that you communicate in multiple modes and in multiple languages. Next slide. And I appreciate, Erica, you're talking about that you might also have to tailor communications to the different levels. I just want to do a quick practice thing. Which of these flyers do you think aligns with the research that shows that chronic absence has to be more readable, fewer words, bulleted, easy to understand? Which one would you think is better at communicating with families? A or B? So pretty good consensus. B is winning this. And the thing that you might want to do with your own communications is take a look at it and say, huh, are my communications readable? Are they bulleted? What information? You can even test it out. Hey, Carolyn, take a look at my flyer. What did you take away from it? And if Carolyn didn't take away the key point, maybe need to rethink the flyer. Next slide. I also want to say we have some resources that are available. We have these handouts, and these are key points. This is meant to be a short one pager. This is something that we produced at Attendance Works, and then we've co-branded with CSDE, and this is available in multiple languages at the this link, which is actually a Connecticut portal. I also encourage you that we're going to be starting to have Attendance Awareness Month again. We'll have our first webinar on March 30th, and you can sign up and make sure that you get access to all of our resources. Next slide. I also really want to encourage, if any of you haven't used it, and you might want to access our student attendance success plans. We think of this as a tier one, tier two, and tier three communications. Everyone should get it, because all of us should have these plans for making sure our kids come to school, and we have backup plans in our health bank. But then if kids and families experience challenges, this is something that's nice to hand out to remind them about the ways that they can track their own attendance and ensure that they have what they need in place to get their kid to school. And again, on our website, it's available in multiple languages. Next slide. I also want to really encourage you to think about not only the communications about when kids generally are missing or how to avoid missing, but when you start to talk to families about truancy. And I know in Connecticut, that's a little bit later because you have sort of up to 8 absences. And then, but actually, if families don't come in with notes, they might be identified before 8 absences as being truant. How you approach families, how you make sure that they feel that they're being welcomed and connected and not blamed is really important. And in California, we actually tried out better truancy notifications and compared the two. When you start with less accessible language and not a more blaming language, you actually get better results than having shorter, easy to read, friendly, caring language. Next slide. And here are some other resources for you. You know, this is a bit of a whirlwind of giving you a ton of information for you to take and digest over time, but we wanted to make sure you saw our chronic absence letter, the Stay the Course Winter Messaging Toolkit that is really relevant right now, that gives you lots of resources about communicating with families and staff about winter, avoiding absences in the winter, both for health related reasons, as well as because of the challenging weather. And then there's also some text messaging information that was created by AIR. Next slide. And I just want those of you to think about it. If you have the opportunity at a school or in your district to develop actually a plan for communications to kind of guide when you do that, you want to think about key elements. Who's your audience? What does the particular group you need to know? And as connected to one of the comments, you might have to think, is it elementary, middle, high, preschool? You know, that's an important part of your audience. What do you want them to do? And how do you want to communicate with them? Next slide. And I also want to make sure you all are aware of our year-round planning calendar. This is something that can help you to think about what you need to do when, at what points of the year. You can even start by filling it out, not in the beginning, but at the middle, you know, the February, the winter time, because that's what we're in. And then over the course of a year, you fill the whole thing out. So you can have that more routinized planning, messaging, as well as interventions and thinking about what you need to do when. That's just so crucial to having the bandwidth to do this work. So at this point, I think we are going to open up for Q&A. We have about 5 minutes, and then we'll do a quick wrap up at the end. But Carolyn, I'm going to turn to you to help us with this.
Thank you, Hetty. And I just wanted to thank you all. I know that the audience, your heads must be spinning with the depth and breadth of information you just heard, and they certainly are the experts. And we are so grateful to them for sharing all of that with you today. So we are just curious, what is on your mind? What is bubbling up while you have these experts in front of you to share their knowledge? What questions might be coming to mind after you've heard all of this information? Feel free to drop questions in the chat or use that reaction tool to raise your hand and we will scroll through and see and just unmute yourself so that we can hear your questions. I do see a question in the chat about asking if we'll be sharing the presentation with resources with you all, and absolutely we will be. So you'll have access to everything we've shared today. So I'm just going to stop talking and let everybody think and see if there are any questions cropping up.
And Carolyn, can I just offer up, they could also have questions for each other. You've got a wealth of experience here in Connecticut. If it's not questions, you can also offer reactions, how this connects to what you're doing in your own school communities.
I think everybody is probably trying to make sense of everything they've heard. Oh, it looks like we have a question in the chat. Looking for some advice and strategies for students who are in tier 3 of absenteeism. Hetty, I will pass that to you.
Sure, I'll take a crack and then Susan and Anika, if you have others to offer. First of all, I really think as you were thinking about tier 3, remember that this is a pyramid. So sometimes when kids are in tier 3, we are actually not creating engaging learning for them and thinking about how the curriculum and what they're doing is meaningful. And we jump to just the case management. But if they don't have something that makes them feel like they ought to be in school and want to be in school and makes them hopeful about being in school and feel like they have a chance for a better future by in school, they might not buy into even if you do case management. So a typical strategy is you might want to figure out for kids who are in tier 3. This is a in California, the foster ed had this approach where these were kids who were either leaving foster care or in the juvenile justice system. So system involved kids, and they would form a group. They would have and they would find champions in 3 systems. One is in their family, in the extended family. And even if they were in foster care, they might have biological family who are still connected to them, the grandma who still cares about them. Someone at the school system and someone who was in the foster care system or the juvenile justice system. And the 3 of those people would have and the kid would form a plan. The data would go out to all of those folks. So there was regularly data. And then when a kid, let's say, had an attendance challenge, anyone who was one of these ed champions would call them, but they had access to the data, they had a plan, and the kid had been part of creating that plan, and that actually improved attendance for those kids. But again, I think we heard from them that if the kid was in a school where, let's say, kids in foster care felt like they were being bullied and not cared about, it made it much harder to implement that plan. So if they didn't feel welcome and connected to school, if they didn't have peers, they didn't have something that made them want to be in school, it's pretty hard to get kids to support it.
Thank you, Hetty. I'm just looking in the chat to see if there are any other questions popping up.
And Kari is also reminding folks that the youth service bureaus can be a real asset for tier three kids. And I will acknowledge your strategy may need to look a little different versus young versus older kids.
There is another question in the chat. When everything positive is in place, how do you engage families who will not partner with the school to improve student attendance? These are elementary age students who are chronically absent year over year. So I will turn that to our Attendance Works team. I don't know who wants to field that one.
Susan, do you want to try, or I can, either way?
Do you want to start? Well, I always wonder when families are not coming, what positive conditions are in place for them. Sometimes what I found is that I thought things were very clear, and sometimes we need to go back and start looking at thinking, how can we encourage those positive conditions? And summertime is often a great time to actually meet with families, or even if you just find a time to meet with families and just to celebrate who their child is, to learn a little bit more about what's going on. Ask those questions. What puts a smile on your face when you think about your child? And really just try to talk to them about their kids, maybe not initially focusing on attendance, but really just learning who that student is and what the family's priorities are.
Anika, I'm just curious if you want to add anything from your experience actually working in communities first before I offer in anything else.
Well, Francisco kind of took the answer. He put it in the chat about maybe doing a home visit. But again, I think to echo what Susan shared is approaching it from kind of like an early approach rather than reactive one. And so just kind of at the core, trying to get to know the families. It just may be some barriers that may not be as evident to the eye on surface level, to maybe trying to understand what those are, but coming from, again, a place of trying to get to know the families individually.
I also wonder if we need to think about different community partners that can help us. So I'm thinking about in our work in Detroit, some of our strongest partners were faith-based members in the community. And they had a very different kind of connection. The family didn't trust the school. So it's not that the family wasn't connected, it's they weren't connected to school, but there were other institutions. And one of the challenges they talked about was that they were willing to help, but they couldn't get enough information from the school about even, they didn't even necessarily want each families, but if they told them which blocks, where families were, they were willing to like do like canvassing because there are confidentiality issues. But sometimes I think we're not creative about who are the other people who are connected to a family. Maybe it's another family. Maybe it's another folk that can actually help you reach. Maybe there was one teacher that had a connection to the family, but the other teachers didn't, and that we're not drawing upon enough knowledge about what might help that family feel supported and connected.
Thank you, Hetty. So many really common sense, research-based suggestions. So hopefully that will be helpful for folks thinking about that. I am mindful of the time. It is 3:02. There are quite a few questions popping up in the chat just asking about resources and the slide deck from today. We will be sharing everything out with folks who were registered. So you will absolutely have access to all of this. One last reminder, and I see that Francisco has put this slide up for us. We really would love to hear from you so that we can think about how to improve the content and materials that we are offering to you through this series. So please, if you wouldn't mind, take a moment to click on that link in the evaluation survey. Susan just dropped it in the chat for you. That would be really helpful to us. And we just wanted to really thank all of you. There is another slide in this deck you'll get when you see it with a host of Connecticut resources. So please take note of those, what is local and available to you, so that as you continue to tackle this issue of attendance and engagement, you can draw upon all of the wealth of resources that CSD has gathered for you. And I'd really just like to end on a note thanking our panel, our team of experts, and thank you to all of you on this snowy afternoon for joining us. Hopefully everybody is home safe and sound already, but if not, safe driving. And please reach out to Kari, to me, to Francisco, to anyone on our Attendance Works team if you have any questions and are thinking about other things as we move into session two of the series. Hedy, I'll pass it back to you to do a final wrap up, but thank you all from EdAdvance and the rest of the CSDE team.
Fabulous. Just a reminder, this is one out of a three-part series, so please come back for the next two sessions. Please feel free to share the resources, and we will be getting you a one-stop shop with all the resources and links and agenda combined with the slides. So yes, that will be going out to all of you. Our hope is that you can use this to make sure the key stakeholders in your districts and your communities are on board, can support this work. And we also know this is learning over time. So just this one webinar is not sufficient. So we really hope you will come back for more. And then just last a couple things, there's a little bit about us, and there are also going to be a few more resources that are at the end of this slide deck when you get it. We'll have more about where you can go up to Showing Up Matters for Real, next slide, our attendance playbook, which we're actually going to release a revamp, but that's something that gives you lots of interventions, and those are just key things that can help of you. And be sure to draw upon each other. You've got amazing practice going on, Connecticut. And so there are plenty of folks in this room that you can call on. You can see great work in action, not to mention the most recently released LEAP program, which Francisco, Kari, lots of folks were part of moving forward, some of the people on the call too. So you've got plenty, a wealth of local resources to move this work.
Thank you, Hedy, and thank you everybody for attending. I hope you have a wonderful afternoon. Take care, all.